Good evening, everyone. I'm so glad that we could have this session here together. And yeah, I know parenting is not such an easy task as it seems. And as you guys have answered, some have said excellent, you've enjoyed it. Others who have found it really challenging. I mean, it's not easy when you become a parent to really tackle many of the issues which you're not prepared for. So there are a few things I would like to share about parenting. And then after that, we can have more specific questions and answers. Vinny will share some of her practical experiences as we go along, and we'll also be able to answer many of your questions. So let me start by sharing. I hope you can all see this presentation, and I thought this is a very nice picture here where you have an elephant. An elephant is such a strong animal, a big animal, and you know that, but it's very gentle. And so I thought it's very apt for the title of this presentation. So we start by looking at, you know, what is natural parenting? This is most of us, we know when we start our life as parents, it's not something that you're really prepared for. We don't go for a class. We don't have any professional degree in parenting. There are maybe very few courses available in parenting. So, and we tend to think that it's something that's very natural and we can do it. And so therefore we struggle with this whole area. And we start because both the husband and wife, myself and Vinny, we come from different backgrounds and we come from different cultures. So when we come together, when it is natural parenting, there is sometimes a clash of cultures because we tend to parent the way our parents parented us. It's sort of an instinctive way and trying to remember and recollect and, oh, what did mama do or what did papa do? And we try to do the same thing. And now cultural influences can be good and bad. And some of the things we have noticed in our country, especially in North India, is when a girl is born, there's a lot of weeping. And when a boy is born, there's a lot of rejoicing. People give out sweets and so on. And we know this bias towards sons is very prominent in our society, which tends to be more patriarchal. And it's very sad, actually, especially in North India, where girls have to eat after the boys are given. I've seen also sometimes when the boys are brought to the hospital for treatment, whereas girls who are sick are kept behind for a long time. And a lot of times when it comes to schooling, the boys are sent to school and the girls are not sent. And these are not very pleasant cultural influences that are there in our culture. And so when we start off parenting, we have to try and identify what are the good things, what are the bad things in our culture, and what are the things that we want when we start our parenting. Of course, we didn't have any girls, so we didn't have that practical, choices to make because we are only three boys. But that's a choice that all of us will have to make when we become parents. And now we know that, you know, there are no differences between boys and girls. The old thinking of only boys are going to support you in your old age is, you know, very much old. In fact, you find that practically it's mostly the girls who support their parents. So I think it's fair to say that we should have balance in the way that we take care of whether boys or girls. Of course, then there is peer influence that happens very subtly. And peer influence is, you know, my friends, my neighbors, what do they think and what do they do? And so, you know, my friend may be saying, you know, she'll give a suggestion. I send my son to these type of classes. They're very good. Or my daughter, she eats only this type of food. And so some of these influences of our peers also affect the way that, and so we learn by doing, and these influences are there in our parenting. And of course, parenting by crisis is something that all parents would have experienced, because until you face a crisis, you won't know. Your baby stops breathing, he swallowed a peanut or something, and he's turning blue. What do I do? And you have to run. It's a crisis, really. Or one of your kids is not eating. He refuses to eat. Or he eats only certain types of foods, and you don't know how to handle it. And then you enter into a crisis, and you ask somebody, and either your mentor or parents, and that's how we learn as we go along. But are there other better ways that we can look at parenting? So what I'm going to look at now is four very simple questions that we usually ask when we look at anything: the who, the why, the what, and the how of parenting. So we'll start with the who. Now see this statement over here: children are not objects to be manipulated, but immature persons to be developed and shaped. Now, the issue is, a lot of times when we are parenting our own children, but a lot of times we tend to forget, because we are in a hurry, we want to get things done, and we have more power than our children. So we tend to, you know, treat them as objects. We try to control them to get them to do the things that we want them to do. And a lot of times we don't have the time or patience to deal with their issues. And so we tend to use power and authority to get them to do what we want them to do. And because they're small and they can't fight against us, you know, they sort of, you know, they have to do some of those things. But we have to remember that children are our own children, come from our body. They're also persons. Even though they're small, they're persons. Now, even in the fetus, the embryo can listen to the sounds of the mother and dad, can feel the emotions of the mother. And so, you know, there's an effect. If the mother is not careful, if she's alcoholic and so on, that affects the children as well. So they are very much persons. They think, they have emotions, they have feelings. And a lot of times people tend to overlook the fact that children have feelings treat them, you know, but they are supposed to be as persons who are in the process of being developed and shaped. And so we have this picture of the potter. And it's good for us to know, those of us who are parents, how do we look on ourselves? What is our role really? And how much should we intervene in our children's lives? So the first thing we say is that they are not objects, but they are persons. Secondly, we'll go on now to the why. Why should we parent? What is the real root reason? Is there a vision or a goal for parenting? Do you have a vision or a goal? A lot of times we don't have, so this is what some of us may think, like this: keeping children happy and engaged. So you'll do everything possible to keep the children happy, give them whatever they ask for, make sure that they are engaged so that they don't bother you. And, you know, that's some of the activities that some people do. Some of us, we think of, you know, children are there to fulfill the desires of parents. And a lot of times parents will, you know, pass on their own dreams to their children. So there are instances of parents who, they wanted to become doctors, they tried very hard, they didn't pass through the exam, and they are very then want to pass on that desire to their children. They want to make sure their children becomes a doctor, engineer, or whatever profession. And so that type of thing at the back of their mind tends to govern the way that they treat their kids, and sort of gently force them into a particular mold of their own, instead of allowing children to develop. And a good vision is developing the hidden potential and building character. so that they can contribute to society in the future. You know, all our children are, like I said, they're little people, and they have a lot of potential, and which needs to be discovered. They themselves don't know. We also don't know. And as they grow up, as we deal with them, we understand and the different talents and potential that is there, their ability to do various things, like the promo which showed the girl who was more interested in playing the guitar and speaking, public speaking, than being a doctor or engineer. And so one of our goal for parenting is to discover that. We are bigger in size, we have greater maturity and understanding. Our job is to help our children to develop, to discover what is already there. And of course, building of character. Character doesn't happen overnight. Character happens when children are go through challenging situations, and we guide them with our right values, help them to know what is the right way to behave, and so on. So what is our goal for parenting? Do you have a goal or vision for parenting? Have you spent time in thinking about what that should be? What is the end product of all the years that I'm going to spend in bringing up my children? You know, we focus on the schooling, and we focus on after that the education, and we all want our children to do well. So as we are doing that, is it only the education part, or is there more than that? Sometimes we tend to focus more only on education, study, study, study. Children go to school, come back, and then to tuition, and at the end of the day, when they come with their, you know, exam cards and say, "Daddy or mommy, I've got 80%. Says, "Oh, only 80%. Oh, with 80%, you'll never get a job. You have to do 95% if you want to get into the good colleges, you know." And so you can imagine how children feel when they hear parents speaking like that. Of course, the parent is thinking that I'm trying to, you know, motivate my child to do better. But it actually tends to demotivate a lot of children. Now, the what. So we looked at the why we are doing parenting, what is the big picture, and keeping that big picture in mind, what do I want to see my son or daughter develop into in the future? And deciding on that is very important. When we do deal with day-to-day issues of discipline and, you know, problems that children face on a day-to-day basis. So God has given us authority over our children. And also because we are bigger and more powerful and more wiser than our children, we have to use this authority appropriately, right? And authority is given to build up, not to put down. So a lot of times, this is the issue we face, and we think by putting the person down, by pointing out all the faults, he'll build up, but it doesn't build up. Authority is meant to build children up. And discipline, having a right understanding of discipline is important. What is the goal of discipline? Discipline is meant to correct a behavior which has already been decided is not appropriate. For example, if you tell a child that you should not put your finger in the electrical on the holes over there, and he goes and does it, you don't punish him unless you have communicated that to him. You know, because children will know what is right and wrong, what are the rules, after we communicate. And so we need to make sure that we don't use it just for punishment. Oh, you didn't do what I told you to do, therefore I punish you. But rather, your behavior was X. We had decided that you will, let's say, come home by 6 o'clock. You didn't come home by 6 o'clock. And because you didn't come home by 6 o'clock, you're grounded or whatever sort of discipline. And it is meant to help the child to recognize that the behavior is not appropriate, and he needs to change in that area. And not for the sake of, you know, punishment. Punishment really doesn't help, but to correct them. And this reinforcement, appreciation and encouragement are much more positive motivators than criticism and control. You know, it's our natural tendency to, all of us, we tend to see the wrong in people rather than the right. We quickly notice the wrong, and sometimes we focus on all the wrong things. And when you keep doing that many over and over again, a child feels very discouraged, because the child starts thinking that, oh, I'm not good enough. Whatever I do, I can't please my mom or dad. And so he feels so small and becomes angry, and then he becomes rebellious, and then that becomes a big problem. But when we appreciate and encourage for every small thing that they do, then that is something that helps children to blossom. This is a good little cartoon that I picked up, and you can see what it says. So the way you communicate is very important. And a lot of times we tend to use words threatening and saying, you know, this is a bad consequence. Now, on the one hand, we tend to threaten. On the other hand, sometimes mothers are so soft, after they threaten, they're not able to carry it out, the threat. And so the children get very confused and they don't know which way to turn. And so when we have a rule, we have to be consistent in the way that we teach and enforce the rule. Otherwise, children get very confused. Okay, then the how. So we looked at the who, that children are persons. We looked at the why, which is the vision or the goal. What is the end product? What is the big picture we must have in mind as we parent our kids? We looked at the what, the appreciation, the discipline, the correction that is required, the input, learning to talk to your children as children, treat them as persons, and encourage them on a daily basis. A lot of times, what happens now, the how part, the nurturing part, you know, what happens when children are very small, they need that interaction with parents a lot. And if what happens nowadays, when both the parents are working, the child comes back to an empty home. There's no one to talk to. And they're told to just sit and read the books or, you know, do their homework. And that's a time when they can get into a lot of trouble. Those who get a little older will start using their phones for playing games or contacting others or doing things which are not appropriate. So loving nurture is very important. And how do we love them? One of the things that we should be aware of when children come back is to listen to them. One of the temptations that a lot of parents have is to, you know, keep giving advice instead of listening to children. And we, even before we understand what is the issue is, and they bring with some problem or complaint that they had in school, we start telling them, no, don't do that. You should do this. Why did you do that? Instead of that, we should be listening and trying to understand what was the real issue. What is the motive that he had, and how, what is the disappointments? What is the fears that he has? What is the anxieties that your child faced? And try to deal with those issues instead of giving commands or giving a lecture or giving advice. And so this quote says, love is patient and kind. And a lot of times we become very impatient with children because, you know, naturally they're immature. They tend to be boisterous at times. They tend to do things which are not always orderly. And we, become impatient. We become irritable. But, love is not jealous or boastful or proud, does not demand its own way. It's not irritable and keeps no record of being wronged. And that is something we shouldn't keep reminding the children of all their mistakes, because then they start thinking of themselves as, no good. And it does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever truth wins. Love never gives up. Sometimes we have children who are not very easy to discipline them, and they're very boisterous. But, if you love that child, you'll keep being patient, helping that person to see and to change. And of course, sometimes you have children who have some learning disabilities, they may be mildly dyslexic and all. And if you shout at them instead of trying to understand their problems, that's, you know, it's terrible. So the how of it is being patient and nurturing them. Now that's why this other quote you can see says we must nurture and love if life is to have any real meaning. But first, we must find a way to survive against the things that prevent us from doing so. So what is in my heart which prevents me from truly being loving? Why am I being impatient? Am I being more selfish, self-centered rather than child-centered? Am I only thinking about, you know, what is convenient for me? Or I try to think of what are the issues that my child needs help with. So those are some questions for us as we look at parenting. Now, this is just an image. It's an image, as you can see very clearly, is a blacksmith. And the blacksmith, you know, he has to deal with an object. And he has to take a piece of iron and make it sharp. And so he uses a lot of hammering. So when you use a lot of hammering and force and control, it's usually for objects and not for people. So if we are using a lot of control and pressure, this is the type of person or parent that we are. Whereas this is a better image, I think, a farmer, because he has to bring about a harvest and he's sowing seed. It's a living thing which grows. And, you know, when you farm, you have to be very patient. You have to make sure that the weeds are taken away. And you have to wait for the takeaway, remove all the pests and wait patiently for the harvest to come. Make sure that the disaster doesn't come and sort of affect. Make sure there's enough watering. And those are, we have a lot of parallels there when you bring up our children to care for them, to make sure that, you know, bad influences don't happen. They don't get caught into things like pornography and other things, and take out the bad habits that are there, help them to develop good habits. And then at the end, you will find the harvest, which is a child who has developed his potential and character and will become a good citizen for the future. And this is just a short, just to differentiate. Our roles are different based on the age. When children are small, you have to be much more directive, especially 0 to 5, because that's the time when they're learning what is right and wrong. And of course, we also have to encourage them. We have to discipline, be like a teacher, set the boundaries for them so they know what is right and wrong and so on. And where correction and discipline are much more important here. You know, when they grow up, it's more of being more of a friend and encourager and coming alongside rather than controlling. And especially when they get into their teenage years, we can't really discipline them like they were small kids, like the one of the short clips that we saw earlier. We have to be more like a friend and advisor and counselor. And understanding what our role is at these different stages is very important. As you understand the growth process that is taking place in the kids, we also change our role in the way that we advise them.